James Dean is the eternal youthful rebel, rejected, sincere, arrogant, sensitive, feared, confused, unloved.
You're tearing me apart!
Violent, lonesome, uncontrollable, moody, and tormented.
You look a certain way, you can't.
That's right, you're absolutely.
You look, you're
absolutely right.
But you're not listening to me!
He was the definitive movie idol. A live-fast, die-young outsider, blessed with the looks, the style, the talent, and the attitude that captivated a generation.
Watching him act, I've never in my life seen anybody as good an actor as he was.
Me, I'm gonna have more money than you ever thought you could have. You and all the rest, you stinking sons of Benedicts.
Everything was perfect. The face, the smile, movements of the body, and the acting, the charm, the voice.
I have never done anything right. I've been going around with my head in a sling for years.
It was like we were brothers in a second. It was just, I liked the guy, and he liked me, and that was that.
He died young, achieving cult status and becoming an icon of American culture.
I said, if you get into that car by 10 o'clock at night next Thursday, you'll be dead. And he was dead the following Thursday afternoon in that car.
When he died at the wheel of his silver Porsche Spyder 50 years ago, his image of rebellious youth was frozen forever.
The reason that he became so iconoclastic is that he was a rebel, and that's what we thought all of us ought to be if you were a teenager.
I gotta know who I am. I gotta know what I'm like.
James Dean was just a sort of image inspiration, this sort of moody character. Did he look cool?
Elvis's rebellion and ours did it via music, whereas Brando and James Dean were doing it on the big screen.
Yet his influence extended far beyond just the image on a movie screen. James Dean represented freedom. He inspired a generation of teenagers to break out of their suburban normality and think for themselves.
All of us were touched by Jimmy, and that he was touched by greatness.
I'm Johnny Depp, and this is the story of James Dean. The son of a dental technician, James Byron Dean was born February 8, 1931, in Marion, Indiana, a small, economically depressed Midwest town 70 miles from Indianapolis. When he was five, his family moved to California. His mother encouraged his artistic side, and he learned tap dancing and violin. When he was nine, his mother died of cancer. His father decided Jimmy would be better off living with his relatives back in Indiana, so he arranged for his mother's coffin to be sent back to Marion for the funeral. Jimmy returned on the same train. He lived with his uncle Marcus and aunt Hortense. His cousin is Marcus Winslow Jr.
His dad was in a bad way financially, and also he didn't have anyone to help him look after Jimmy, and my mom offered to take Jimmy. I think probably at the time they didn't know if it was temporary or permanent. We all felt like he was a very ordinary boy. Of course, he came to live with my parents after the death of his mother, and Jimmy was 9 years old then, and I wasn't born until 3 years later, so my memories of him is just like an older brother being around. I've heard my sister talk about him quite a bit, and she tells the stories about when she'd have a girlfriend over to visit her or something, why they'd go upstairs in her room, and Jimmy would sneak upstairs. She could hear the stairway squeaking, and she'd holler down and tell my mom, tell Jimmy to get back downstairs, and he would, but then she said wasn't very long, he'd ride back up there again.
His uncle Marcus was a Quaker minister who taught Jimmy to love car racing and classical music, especially Bartok and Stravinsky.
The poor bastard, everything he loved, he lost.
Michael J. Sheridan, director of James Dean, Forever Young.
Obviously, his mother died when he was nine. 3 days later, his father gave him up for all intents and purposes, so he lost both parents within 3 days. He loved the people that raised him, but as he grew up on the farm, he was involved with a 4-H club, and he raised a little pet goat. And he came home from school one day, and they sat down, and they were having dinner, and his uncle Marcus Sr. said, "How's your dinner?" And he said, "All right." He said, "Well, you should enjoy it because it's Billy." It was his pet goat that they had slaughtered for dinner. Jimmy ran away for a week. They couldn't find him anywhere. And I confronted Marcus Jr. and I said, is that true? And he sort of chuckled and he said, yeah, that was my father.
I'm sure that he missed his mother after she died, and he probably missed his father some, but my folks said they never heard a word from him that, you know, it was bothering him or anything, and I think he adjusted very well. He considered them probably his main parents by the time he got out of high school.
Jimmy was nearsighted and wore very thick glasses, even when excelling at sports. His other passions were art and drama, and he spent his high school years as a prominent member of the drama club.
My mom was kind of artistic. She liked to paint, and Jimmy's dad was kind of an artist. He'd sketch and draw things, and Jimmy just kind of picked it up. I think Jimmy's mother, before she passed away, she was very close to Jimmy, and they had a little puppet set they used to play with, and they'd kind of do little plays with these puppets. And so, you know, I think some of it was a talent that he probably inherited.
After graduating from high school, Jimmy returned to California to live with his father. He enrolled in a pre-law program before switching to a performance arts course in 1950. That was the year he saw a film called The Men, which featured the film debut of Marlon Brando. Dean was deeply affected by Brando's performance in The Men and decided to devote all his energies to becoming a method actor. With encouragement from James Whitmore, Jimmy headed to New York to try his luck on Broadway. He auditioned for the Actors Studio and became one of the youngest students to be accepted. But he was more interested in having a good time and took bongo lessons from percussionist Cyril Jackson, learned photography with Roy Schat, and went to dancing lessons with Eartha Kitt. While working various jobs and auditioning for off-Broadway productions, Jimmy became friends with another struggling young actor, Martin Landau.
I came in and I sat down with my number, and there was this guy sitting next to me with glasses, and I'd never seen him before. He'd just arrived in New York. So I said, what's your name? He said, Jim. What's yours, Marty? I said, first time here? And he said, yeah. You? I said, my last. And that was literally the first conversation we had. We went up there, and they looked us over, and they said, thank you very much, and we walked out. And we went into the drugstore and had some coffee. Up until this time, I hadn't talked to him that much. We were busy playing. When we sat down in Cromwell's, that was really our first conversation. That's when he told me he'd been in California, and he went to UCLA, and he worked with Jimmy Whitmore. And this is winter of 1953. We exchanged phone numbers, and within a day or two, I got a call from him. He said, what are you doing? I said, I don't know. What the hell are you doing?
He decided to go to New York because at that time, the TV work was all in New York. Did a couple Broadway plays and approximately 40 television shows. A lot of people, I think, had the feeling that he was just an overnight success, but he wasn't. He really struggled and worked hard.
There were some flat rocks in Central Park, not too far from the zoo, and we would sit there and solve the problems of the world and watch the girls go by. We talk about Marlon, we talk about the future, we talk about acting techniques. The 50s in New York were an exciting time. There was a great sense of camaraderie and rivalry, and theater was happening, Arthur Miller, Tennessee Williams, and all of this stuff was going on, and it was all centered around the Actors Studio.